Om sthapakaya cha dharmasya sarva dharma swarupine avatara varishthaya Ramakrishnaya te namaha Jananim Sharadam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagadgurum Padapadme tayoshritva pranamami muhurmuhuh. Till now you have been listening to a discourse in Tamil of Swami Vimurthanandaji. He has given you many details about the glorious life of Holy Mother Sarada Devi. He has also mentioned that this is Sarada Devi's 164th birthday. 163 years over, but birthday is always plus one, because on the day a person, a child takes birth, that is the first birthday. At the end of the one year, what you celebrate is second birthday. It is first anniversary of the birth, but it is the second birthday. Therefore, the 163 years are over. This is the 164th birthday. So, you have heard the glorious life of Mother. The same, more or less, the same theme is dealt by me. There will be some overlapping of incidents. But, avrittihi asakrit upadeshat, in Brahma Sutra, it is said that you can repeat a good thing again and again, because you do not understand by first listening complete meaning of it. Therefore, avrittihi, repetition, is to be done. That is the teaching of the Upanishads. So like that, even if it is overlapping, you hear it for the second time in a different language. Here we see, when we see the glorious life of Mother, we see the tremendous Mother's love in her life. Hundreds of incidents are there which reveals the selfless love of the Mother, the supreme love of the Mother. And we also see Mother's infinite knowledge. Sri Ramakrishna used to call her, "She is my Saraswati." But for all outward purposes, we don't see any Saraswati in her. She has not gone into school. She could not, in the last stages of her life, she had learnt a little writing. She forgot even to write her name as Ma. She used to sign some of the papers only with Ma. That Ma also she forgot. So, but Sri Ramakrishna called her, "She is my Saraswati, she is my Shakti." And we see in her life, whenever she has opened herself out in one or two, three incidents, you find this tremendous knowledge which no one else could have had except Saraswati. We also see her encouraging the heroism in people. She was not a mother who would only make namby-pamby children. He wanted her children to be heroes. So always she would give such advice, by following which her children, both boys and girls, would become real heroes, courageous and daring to do the right thing. And we also see in her life that she is very easily accessible. We are able to go to her very easily, whereas it is not so easy to go near any spiritual man. First of all, there is a sort of a fear, and less than that fear, you will have hesitation. And then after this fear and hesitation is overcome, then slowly you go near. But with Mother, we see everybody is going directly to her. They never feel any fear, they never feel any hesitation, because of her unique nature, she would be so easily accessible. We also see her in her life. She exhibits a heart such as so big, which is very difficult to fathom the depth and the width of her heart, of her heart. Swami Sharadanandaji, who stayed with her as her sevak from almost 1899 to 1920, 21 years, he stayed with her almost 24 hours. And she says, I stayed for 24 hours with mother, but I could not understand her. Perhaps it is never be able to understand, even if I stay another 20 years also. That was the depth and the width of mother's heart. Several incidents are there. And we see her also in her life, extraordinary feature of forgiveness. She can forgive anything. There is nothing which is so serious which she can say, I will not forgive. She forgives everything, so many offenses against her own, causing her immense anguish and anxiety. She excuses immediately. That forgiveness is something very unique in her life. And then, of course, we see in her life divinity, divinity, divinity. In whatever she says, whatever she speaks, whatever she does, there is divinity that is revealed, that she is the Lord of the whole universe. She can at this time, she can order anybody, she can get anything done, she can drive away death, she can invite all the devatas into her house. She says in one place, vision of God that is always on the palm of my hand, is, she says, whenever I think, I can see any God, any goddess. So this is the divinity we see in her life. So there are so many facets of her life, each one giving you several incidents are there in her life. It is an ocean. So we shall take, because on this famous auspicious day, we should remember something about her life. Therefore, we shall think about, reminisce one or two, three or four incidents in her life. Her mother's love. Mother's love, we see, it is a very simple incident, all of you know. Sri Ramakrishna was a very hard taskmaster. He used to instruct all his young disciples to be very austere when staying with him in Dakshineshwar. He used to say, these young people have to do sadhana, they have to do spiritual practices throughout the night, therefore they should not eat heavily. They should be given very scarcely, so a small food only. So he instructed Holy Mother, you give to Sharat Maharaj so much chapati, or Vivekananda chapati, and for Premananda this much chapati. So mother kept it in her mind. Then one day Sri Ramakrishna wanted to check whether Holy Mother is following his instruction. So one of them, it was Premananda. He asked, Premananda, how much chapati did you take today? He said, I took 6 chapatis. Eh? 6 chapati? I had told Sarada Devi to give you only 4. Why did you take 6? How did she give you 6? Immediately he went to mother and then said, did I not tell you that you should give only 4 chapatis to Premananda? She said, yes. And then, why did you give him 6? Do you know how their spiritual life will be spoiled? They have to meditate in the night, and if you feed them heavily like that, then they will go to sleep. They will not be able to meditate. Immediately, mother's love comes in. She says, for this small thing, you don't have to take him to task. Don't tell anything about it. And about his spiritual practices, you don't have to worry, I will take care of it. This is mother's love. Mother always intercedes. She will not nullify the husband's words, but she gives an alternative for it. You think that you are the only person who can do it, I can also do it. Therefore, you don't worry. So, after hearing this, the biographer writes, Sri Ramakrishna was very happy that his wife disobeyed him. So, she was very happy. But was it for the disobedience he was happy? No. He was happy because the Divine Mother herself, who has closed the door for salvation for every one of us, who's opening the door will open the doors of the highest enlightenment to everyone. She has herself taken the responsibility of Babana Maharaj. What else does he need? So he has achieved the highest by the mother's love. So Sri Ramakrishna went away very happily. There are several incidents like this. Mother's love. Mother's way of dealing with the same thing can be dealt with the mother's heart, and same thing will be dealt from the father's heart also. Both of them wish the same good thing to the child, but the method of their application is different. And as far as the mother's all-knowingness, Saraswati-ness, so we have got so many examples. One or two only will do. Swami Abhedananda, he was a young monk in Alam Bazar Mutt. So he suddenly got inspired. He wrote a poem, a hymn about Holy Mother. Prakritim paramam abhayam varadam nararupadharam janatapaharam. Very beautiful poem. So here where he describes Mother as the supreme Prakriti, the primal energy, Shakti, Brahma Shakti. So he went to Nilambar Babu garden where Holy Mother was staying. So this young Swami went and said, Mother, I have written a hymn about you. I want to read it out to you. You have to hear. Mother said, yes, you read. So Mother stood or sat before him. Then he recited the whole hymn. As he was reciting, Mother went into Samadhi. It was so nice. She went into Samadhi and he comes down from Samadhi and blessed him. Boy, Saraswati will sit on your tongue and speak. She blessed him like that. Saraswati will always sit on your tongue and she will speak through your tongue. And this blessing was so evident later. Swami Vivekananda, we all know, preached in America 4 years, America and Europe. And afterwards another 1 year he went. So maximum 5 years he taught Vedanta in the West. After Swamiji's return in 1902, for up to 1922, 20 years Avedananda Swami spoke and spread the message of Vedanta. And people used to wonder about his depth of knowledge. Many people used to mistake him for Sri Ram Swami Vivekananda himself. They had not seen Vivekananda, but he looked like Vivekananda. His fluency in language, his depth of knowledge, and tremendous experience in spiritual life. So he goes to seances where, you know, ghosts are invited. And so they had so many dealings with the ghost. So they invited him, please come and see how the ghosts are invoked on people. He went to see, let me see what this ghost do. But when he went and said, no ghost would come at all. So that fellow who was conducting the show, seance show, so he said, so the ghost does not want to come at all. Then he started praying to the ghost, what is this? A very important guest has come. You are not coming at all. So we will get a very bad name. Then that ghost, it does not, it didn't appear at all. It says from behind, no, 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 we are ashamed to come before him. He knows more about the ghost than we ourselves know, she says. That means this Swami has got such depth of knowledge of not only our world, of all the ghost world, the divine world, everything he knows. Blessings of Sarada Devi. One blessing, the Saraswati will dance upon your tongue. So, in another incident, one disciple went to Holy Mother. She was staying in Mudbodhan at that time. Sharat Maharaj was his doorkeeper. Swami Sharadananji used to call himself as doorkeeper of Mother. He would, anybody wants to go to Mother, they would first meet him and then he would allow them. After giving information to Mother, so-and-so is coming, wants to meet you. Then after taking Mother's permission, he would send him up. So one young man wanted to meet Mother and wanted to take initiation. Then Sharat Maharaj spoke to him, Sharadananji, then sent him up. Then Mother spoke to him. Mother also agreed to initiate him. Mother initiated him in a mantra. He came down, that young man. Somehow or other, Sharadananji on that day felt inquisitive and then asked, were you initiated? Yes. What was the mantra that Mother gave? And that young man repeated the mantra. But Sharat Maharaj got a little doubt. This mantra seems to be not all right. It is not complete. So then he said, did Mother tell this mantra, you remember correctly? He said, yes. But better you go. Another time, you verify from Mother, go. So he went again. Then Mother asked, why are you come again? Sharat Maharaj sent me to verify this mantra with you. Then you tell the mantra, mother said. He repeated the mantra. It's all right, you go. So he came. So when he came down, again Sharat Maharaj asked, so did you get the mantra corrected? No, she says it is all right. You should say all right. Again, the doubt of Sharat Maharaj is not going. Then he sent him for the third time. Please go and get it verified whether it is right. And tell that I have sent you. Then this time when the young man went and told mother that Sharat Maharaj has sent me to get it verified. Then mother became a little cross. She said, what does Sharat know about mantra? Sharat Maharaj is a Brahmajnani. He is a man who has realized God, who has attained Samadhi, because he writes in the introduction of Ramakrishna, the great master, the biography of Sri Ramakrishna, I have not written in this book anything which has not been my personal experience. In that one, he writes about the Samadhi of Sri Ramakrishna, different Samadhis, Nirvikalpa Samadhi, Savikalpa Samadhi, Bhava Samadhi, all about Samadhi he writes. But in the introduction he writes, I have not written in this one a single word which has not been my own experience. Such a Sharat Maharaj, mother says, what does Sharat know about the mantras? It's all right, you go. And then that young man went away with it. Then Sharat Maharaj, mother afterwards, after some time, she left this world in Mahasamadhi. After some years, Sharat Maharaj came across, by going through the Tantra literature, in one book, which was not very popular, this mantra that mother has given is there in that book. Sharat Maharaj, who is a scholar and a sort of a deep knowledge with all the tantras, because he himself had taken tantric sadhanas, done tantric sadhanas, taken tantric sannyasa, such a person, after so many years he found that the mother's mantra was correct. So he just felt, how can I know the mind of the mother, which I could not know all my life with all my researches. Mother knows, just like that. And she has given that mantra to her, to the young man. So that is mother's Saraswatiness. What nobody knows, she knows everything. So, and she says in another place, people come to me and they go on complaining to me, mother, mother, we don't have the vision of God. When will we have the vision of God? Then mother says, in a very simple way, why should they not have the vision? You see, whenever I think, I get the vision. But the vision seems to be upon the palm of my hand. Whenever I wish, I can have the vision. So mother has got this depth, this divine knowledge with her. So she can see any god or any goddess. Once Sharadananji was asked by a young man. So just like that, the young man was very free with Swami Sharadananji. And he told Sharadananji, Swamiji, you see, when the Holy Mother initiates, she takes only 2 or 3 minutes to initiate. We go and then she makes her sit on the seat and then she just sprinkles some water, she utters the mantra and the initiation is over. But you take 15 minutes, 20 minutes, half an hour, why should it happen like that? Then Sharat Maharaj became very cross with him. Said, don't compare me with the Holy Mother. She is incomparable. You cannot compare me with Holy Mother. But then he explains it to that young man. You see, the reason is, Holy Mother is always living in God. There is no time when she is away from God. What you call a Sahaja Samadhi. Dhrita Sahaja Samadhim Chinmayam Komalangam Vimala Paramahamsam Ramakrishnam Bhajamaha. The Ramakrishnananji wrote about Sri Ramakrishna, Sahaja Samadhi. In a normal way, they are in the Samadhi itself. This is Sri Ramakrishna state. Holy Mother state was exactly like that. As Sri Ramakrishna lived always in Samadhi, sometimes he would come down. Holy Mother also was in the same state. Always she was in Samadhi. She would come down. But in Sri Ramakrishna, when you would go into Samadhi and come out of Samadhi, it is visible. But Holy Mother was so powerful, she would hide even that going into Samadhi and coming into Samadhi. She was in the same state, but she could hide herself, that she had that tremendous power of keeping herself away from the public gaze. That was a special power given to her. So this Saraswatiness, all-knowingness, we see her in so many incidents. Then, as I was telling, she did not like namby-pamby children. She would always say, be heroes, be daring, you must be daring and courageous to face the truth, to protect the truth. So one disciple of her, one Surendra, he was a teacher in a high school. He was headmaster of a school in Bangladesh. At that time it was called Purba Banga, the East Bengal. So there the majority were Muslims. And then by the side of his school, there was a Muslim gentleman living. So he used to every now and then cut the cows. So that is this Hindu school and the children in the Hindu school and the staff, they did not relish it. But then what could be done? So he is a Muslim, so according to his religion, so we can take beef just as you take meat. He would just say and he would go on slaughtering up. One day he went to an extreme of fleecing the cow, even if it is alive. Cutting it is one thing, fleecing it, and it is alive, just take out the skin. That was simply aghast. They could not bear that. Immediately they went and protested, and then they drove him away from this heinous crime, and then all the school children, staff, and this headmaster were perturbed. Then this headmaster came all the way to Jayarambati and told mother, mother, you see such a heinous crime he was doing, but we all drove him away. But that fellow, he says, he is going to take vengeance upon us. What vengeance he can do? He can bring gundas and then finishes off also, especially me. He may easily kill one person is nothing. Even now, it is also very easy. At that time, it was much more easy. So it was their own country. Then he said, see, my life is in danger. What should I do now? Then mother tells him like a Veera Mata, like a mother of heroes. What? He is doing such a heinous crime. Killing a cow is so brutally, so mercilessly. You should protest. It is a sin against which you should fight. Let him do whatever he wants. You fight against him, go to the court also if necessary. I am there behind you. If God is true, you will get the justice. Mother assures him. He goes back with the mother's assurance, sues that man in the court. You see, by the side of the Hindus, just to enrage the Hindus, he is doing all these things. Court intervened, which is very rare, and then stopped that sort of heinous crime. So mother would be, like such mother, would say, be heroes, face the trouble to protect the truth, to protect the weak against the strong. Once, you know, one Sindhubala, one girl, she was wrongly arrested by the police. It was the British time. They accused her of doing something against the government. So they caught the wrong Sindhubala. There were two Sindhubalas. One Sindhubala has committed what the government called as a crime. So they arrested some other Sindhubala who was not that Sindhubala. They made her walk all the way for 2 or 3 miles in the sun. They took her to the police station. This news was published. Then all people were very much grieved about this one. They went and reported to mother. Mother, as soon as she heard, she became very much moved. Her eyes got filled up with tears. And then she said, what? Were there no men folk there? When they were taking this wrong girl and made her walk all through to several miles to go post up to the police station, were there no men there? They should have slapped that police on the cheek and snatched away the girl, whatever may be the consequences. See the mother advising. It could have been a very serious thing. If they had slapped, they would have been put into jail, or they would have been hanged also, or worse, they would have been sent away to Andaman Nicobar. All these things would have come. Mother knows it. But it was the duty of the menfolk to be heroes, to protect the truth. You must dare to do. This was mother's. One lady used to come to her. She was unmarried at that time, but she was very helpful to the revolutionaries. And then afterwards she got married. So when she got married, though she could not help the revolutionaries in carrying so many small errands, the revolutionaries wanted somebody's address or somebody's whereabouts, somebody whether he's in India or outside India. All these things, you know, this young lady could easily get without the knowledge of the government. She would supply to the revolutionary struggle, people who are struggling against the British government, strip freedom struggle. And this lady, when she got married, she got into a dilemma. So now I cannot go and help these revolutionaries, but I have helped them all these days, therefore they depend upon me for all this information, for all these errands. And now if I stop, their activity against the, for the freedom struggle will become weak. What shall I do? But I have, as a housewife, I cannot do this. She went to Holy Mother. Holy Mother knew her well. Holy Mother, she told her, Mother, I was unmarried at that time. So my people were not very much in favor. But I was helping these freedom struggle people. But now I am married. In-laws are also there. Parents are also there. So many people are there. So they will not allow me to do this. What shall I do? What is my duty? Mother said, do you think that only men folk will struggle for the Indian freedom struggle? Will not the women do anything? Mother, but I have a housewife. What should I do? He said, you must do your duties as a housewife also. You must help these revolutionaries also. Why should you not help? At that time, as a young woman, unmarried woman, you had one method of doing. You can find some other method. You can help these revolutionaries in your own way. This was the mother's heroicness. She always encouraged heroism in her children, both boys and girls. Once, you know, and Holy Mother's another great unique feature was, anybody could approach her very easily. One lady wanted to visit her. She had come newly to Calcutta. So she caught hold of her another devotee of Holy Mother. She said, please take me to Holy Mother. I've got great desire to see her for the last several years. But now only I have been able to come to Calcutta. I stay in Bangladesh. So you please take me. So that another lady who is a devotee of Mother, she brought her. They have to do the household duties. And then by the time they finish the household duties and take the public bus and come, then it is 11:30 past. By 11:30, the puja itself is over and Mother goes to rest afterwards. So she cannot see the Mother. So first day she comes, she could not meet Mother. So they go back. Next day they try. However much they try, again second day also they come late, at about 12 o'clock. There also Mother is taking rest. Then every time they come, Golapma notices. Golapma is the assistant, the gendarme for Mother. So as soon as she sees somebody is doing something wrong, she scolds also. So both the days they got scolding. That devotee who knew Holy Mother's program, that after 11:30 she is not available, or after 12 o'clock she is not available, and the temple also will be closed. Two times she got scolding. And third day also, that new lady, she did not want to miss seeing Mother. She says, let us try our level best to go earlier today. So that day also, with great difficulty, they would come some 2 minutes earlier. 12 o'clock they used to come, some 2 minutes earlier. That day also Mother was almost on the threshold of her room. She was standing at the room just to go in. Suddenly these people appeared on the first floor. So Mother saw. As soon as Mother saw, she beckoned them. Come, come, come. So directly they went to Mother. So Golapma noticed this. Then Golapma noticed, but she could not say because Mother has called her. So they went and Mother talked to them so kindly. She welcomed them, that easy access. Mother herself starts talking first. This is the way. All great people, they make themselves easy of access. Saulabhya paripurnaya, sattvodriktaya mangalam. about Ramachandra, saulabhya paripurna. Saulabhya means, labhu means to get. Sulabha means to get easily. So Sri Ramachandra was very easy to get. How? As soon as he sees you, you don't have to tell what, why you have come. Come, come. How do you come? He himself asks. That is the easy of access. Mother, they did not tell anything. Mother said, come, come. Already she has been invited. And mother talked to them. Did you get scolding from Golakman 2 days? She has somehow come to know. And then they said, yes, 2 days we got scolding because we were a little late. Today also we were about to get scolding, but Golapma saw that you are beckoning, therefore she has gone away without scolding us. Then mother, almost like apologizing for the fault of Golapma, you see, that is her nature. Please don't take it to heart. Now come, what have you got to say? She hears them, blesses them in every way. This was mother's easy of access. So this easy of access is the great quality of all the great avatars. Mother was so easy. Anybody who wants to meet her, she was in Kashi for some days. She would go whenever possible to Kashi and stay in one of her devotees' house. Lakshmi Nivas is there, very near our ashram there. She used to stay there. Once she was staying there, so one beggar girl, maybe hardly 10 years or 12 years old, so this girl was singing very beautifully a nice song. So mother hears from the first floor the voice of this girl. She asks Golapma, who is that who is singing so well? Call that. Then they called her. She is a 12-year-old girl. And this girl, as soon as she comes, mother also starts talking to her. Come, come, dear girl. Where do you do? Where do you stay? She, as soon as she sees, she knows she is a beggar girl. So, where do you stay? She says, oh, I am staying in Dashashwamedh Ghat, very near the temple. Then, do you get your alms every day, daily? Your bhiksha every day? Then this girl says, oh, by the grace of Annapurna, I get enough to keep myself healthy and satisfied. Enough for bhiksha I get every day. Then, oh, that is very good. And then this girl says, but I am comfortable in that way, mother, but I don't know anything about bhakti. I would like to get some bhakti. Then mother says, certainly, you sing so well, and Annapurna's place you are living, you will certainly get bhakti. You sing one or two more songs. She sits there and hears one or two songs from that girl. Then she gives her some present, some fruits, etc., and then tells her, that girl tells, I am so satisfied, mother. I was afraid to come here because you are such a big person. People, will they allow me to come near you? Therefore, I was afraid to come. Therefore, I could not come. But I knew that all these days you are here. No, 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 you don't have to feel hesitant. You come here and you say that you want to meet me. Nobody will stop you. And whenever you want, you come here. And she gives her some fruits and scents. And then that girl comes again also, another day. Again, she entertains her, talks to her. So much of easy of access. Poor girls, poor people were not poor for her. Their devotion was the thing that she would always see. One another lady, she brought a simple sari on one day. That was perhaps mother's birthday. And she brought, so many people have brought so many presents of saris and other things. So very valuable things have been brought. And she was almost hesitant to give the small present. It was just an ordinary textile sari. And then, but she gave it to mother. And then said, mother, so many people have brought so many valuable things. I was hesitant to give this one to you. But this is all I could afford. So I have brought this one. Mother immediately takes it. Why do you say it is an ordinary thing? I find it so nicely. Its design is so good. I am going to wear it immediately. She goes and changes her cloth and wears this new one. And that girl, that lady, simply was in tears of joy. How mother is kind to me. This was the easy access of mother. And mother of all, she had such a big heart. There was no difference at all between anybody. Anybody would go and call her mother. She could not say no to him, no to her or him. So, Bhagdi people, Bhagdis were those people who just stopped her when she was going to Dakshineshwar, that Bhagdi couple, two robbers, husband and wife, they belong to the Bhagdi caste. Similarly, one Bhagdi boy came after several years, he wanted Diksha from mother. Then mother said, come, I will initiate you. And then she initiated that Bhagdi boy. And then Amzad, he is a Muslim. So she used to consider him as her own relatives. So she would, when he would come, she would make him sit in the veranda, she would serve food, she would herself take out the leaf plate and clean it. In spite of all the protestation from her attendants there. And then, when Amzad would go to jail, he would be arrested for so many crimes. When he would be disappear from the society and would be in jail, his family would be in difficulty. Mother would send something to his family so that during the absence of Amzad, that family will have some peaceful time. This motherliness to all, irrespective of caste or creed, one of her disciples was a very, very loving disciple. She was a young widow. Somehow or other, mother had special love for that. So this lady, which became so intimate, almost whenever she used to be in Calcutta, from morning till evening, she used to spend with mother. Mother also liked her company. One day, the other attendants of mother, like the Maku and Radhu and these young girls there, they got inquisitive to find out what is the caste of this lady. She is coming from morning till evening and sir, mother is loving her like anything. So we must know much about her. And they asked her to come to them and she went to them. Then they are all sitting around, four or five of them. They are asking her, Acha, what do you do? Who are at your home? Etc. etc. She told everything. Then at last they asked, what is your caste? And she was very hesitant to tell. It is a very tricky question. So because she had heard that mother did not like to discuss this caste at all, she would never consider anybody's caste. So mother may also not like if I reveal the caste. So she was just looking this way and that way. In the meanwhile, mother came to know that these ladies are pestering her to tell what her caste is. In the mother came herself. He said, what do you want to know about her? You ask me, I will tell everything. You need not ask her at all. I will tell, you tell. So they went on and asked her so many other questions other than caste. Mother went on giving answers about her. That lady says, I had never told mother anything about it. She tells my father's name, my mother's name, my village, at what age I was married, at what age I was widowed, and what are all the tribulations I went through. I was stunned. Mother knows everything about me. And at last, these ladies asked mother, so what is her caste? She does not want to tell us. I will also not tell you, she said. I will not also tell you, because there is no caste for devotees. Devotees have no caste. So that was mother's heart. So she was beyond all barriers and she silenced all those people. And later on, how many people came to her? We talk about Muslim Amzad, Parsi Saurabh Modi went to her. Then Nivedita went to her, an Irish girl. Holy Bull and then MacLeod, Americans went to her. Christine, etc. All she accepts as her own daughters. When Nivedita went to her, she was new. Swami Vivekananda wanted Nivedita to be accepted by Indians. How to know that Indians will accept? That is only in the future. So how to know that future India will accept Nivedita, a foreign girl, to work among the orthodox people of Calcutta? Then that's why she sent Nivedita, you go to mother. If mother accepts you, India will accept, the world will accept. Then when she came to mother, and then she announces, mother, my name is Margaret Noble. Mother said, no, I cannot utter that long name. I will call you as my cookie, my child. So you are my dear child. She accepted her as her child. And then as soon as she accepted, that very moment, she became her child, she became her mother. Then she gives her prasadam. Then Sister Nivedita eats, and after giving her, mother also takes prasadam along with her. So the three pictures that you see, the picture that you worship, it was taken at that time only. When mother has accepted Nivedita, she has given her prasadam, they have taken prasadam in the sitting side by side. After that, the photographer was there, so he takes the photograph. First one was with the eyes down. Second one was eyes up. She is looking at us. That is the thing we worship. Third one is the sister Nivedita and mother are sitting side by side on the same cot. That is in sister Nivedita's room, her school, where in that room mother has gone. So this was the mother's love. She was beyond all caste, creed, color, nationality. And then she would also see the young people fighting for the country. So she would encourage them also, but in a positive way. He said, what is the good of sloganeering? Simply sloganeering will not take you anywhere. So your country also will not progress in any way. Do work for the poor, as Swami Vivekananda has said. So the poor are to be uplifted, poor are to be educated. When education and then economic prosperity comes, people will fight for their own freedom. You don't have to sloganeer there. You don't have to go on shouting slogan. They themselves will fight for their rights. So do something. You also give me charkha. I will just spin in the charkha. This was the spirit of mother, to be, not to hate anyone, but do something positively to lift up those that need the help. So even in the national movement, all people in a way advocated hating the British. It was only perhaps two people who did not advocate hate of the British. One was Gandhi, and earlier two was Holy Mother. Holy Mother was the person, he says, I cannot hate Britishers. They are also my children. I cannot hate. Therefore, and later on it was Gandhi who said, I hate that British regime, but not the Britisher. Britishers are good. They are people just like us. We don't have anything against them. But we want that regime must go. So Holy Mother was so large-hearted. And she was forgiveness personified. There is no big crime, even against her own self, she could not forgive. Once, you know, when Sri Ramakrishna has left Kasipur Garden, he has left Dakshineshwar to come over to, first of all, Shampukur, then to Kasipur Garden. He was staying in Kasipur Garden. One day this Golapma, mother was staying in Dakshineshwar alone. At that time, this Golapma, she was a rather foolish talker sometimes. Too much of talk she used to do. Later on, it became a sort of a, everybody knew it. So Sharat Maharaj used to say, if Golapma gives one coconut to anybody, the whole Udbodhan will know that she has given a coconut. She will make so much noise about it. So this Golapma, very loose talker, but a great sadhika. Mother herself used to appreciate her. And this lady, by just speaking something in connection with something, she has said to mother, you see, Sri Ramakrishna has left this Dakshineshwar to go away to Kasipur because he was angry with you. And so this was too much for mother. Sri Ramakrishna would not, mother again and again would say, Sri Ramakrishna did not hurt me even with a flower. Once she called me by a singular you, thou, tui. So he addressed her tui, not knowing that she was, thinking that she was Lakshmi, his niece. But then he found that it was Holy Mother. So Sri Ramakrishna was so much grieved. Whole day he went on telling her, see how I was cruel to you. I addressed you as tui, as thou. Such was his kindness to me. And this lady says she has become cross with me and has left Dakshineshwar and gone away. I must go and know this truth. She walked all the way to Kasipur Garden and met Sri Ramakrishna. Say, is it true that you came away being angry with me? Then Sri Ramakrishna said, who told you like that one? Then she said, Golap says like that. Did she? I'll take her to task, let her come next time. And unfortunately she came immediately after some time to Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna thrashed her right and left. Do you know who she is? She is my Shakti, she is Saraswati. So you had offended her. Go immediately, walk all the way back to Dakshineshwar and apologized. So she was in tears. So I told it inadvertently that it was my fault. So she came all the way. She was all the way thinking, I have spoken such harsh words against mother. Will she ever excuse me? When she came, she was thinking, at least she will give me a good scolding. But when she came and started weeping, my Sri Ramakrishna sent me here to apologize to you. Oh, Golab, come, what is there to apologize? She just embraced her and both of them forgot about it. She forgave her. Such a serious offense, but she did not even mind. She did not take even a minute to think about it. That was forgiveness personified. And of course, we shall close with her divinity. Her divinity was there evident in everything she spoke, everything she did. She was the divinity personified. One Tarakeshwarananda story I must have told here. One young man took Diksha from her. And then after some time, he comes back to her and tells her, she was in Udbodhan at that time. He tells her, "Sir, mother, I have taken Diksha from you, but every time I meditate, but my mind, instead of thinking about God, it thinks of all the hellish things in the world. So my mind is so impure, I don't deserve to be your pupil, your disciple. So this is the last time we meet." He just touched her feet and was about to walk away. Immediately mother got up and then stopped him, putting her hand on his shoulder. Then she told him, "Look back, look here." And he looks back. Mother is putting her hands on his shoulder. He looks back to mother and she looks into her eyes. Her eyes are full of compassion, as if an ocean of compassion. So he looks the compassion flowing into him. And then mother says, "If bad thoughts trouble you, don't be afraid. Face them." How to face them also, she says, "Think about me." She tells him two things. If bad thoughts haunt you, don't be afraid. Face them and think about me. If you think about me, all bad thoughts will fly away. That is the idea. So, and then mother comes back and sits in her own seat. Then this young man walks off. He is going to his house, walking all the way, reaches the house after 1 or 2 hours. All the while he could not forget the face of mother with her compassionate eyes looking at him and telling him, "Don't be afraid of bad thoughts. Face them. Think about me." So the same thing is going on, repeating in his mind. By the time he goes home, his mind has become calm. Then after the first day, second day, third day, that calmness continues to be with him because he is thinking about her. And the whole bad thoughts have been driven away. After some time, then he comes to Belur Mutt, where Swami Brahmananda was there. He was the president. He told him, "Sir, I want to become a brahmachari here." And Swami Brahmananda was the last man to admit anybody, whoever may be, however pure he may be. At least for one year, 1.5 years, he would make him come up and down. Then only he would give him chance to become a brahmachari. As soon as this young man said, "I want to become a brahmachari," "Yes, you join the brahmachari." He admitted him as a brahmachari. Later on, he became a very famous sadhu of our order, known for his austerities. He stayed in Kankal, Haridwar, for a long number of years. He did a lot of austerities there. And Swami Brahmananda, when he went to Kankal, he sent word for him, "I want to meet this young man. His name was Tarakeshwarananda. Call Tarakeshwarananda." Then Tarakeshwarananda came. Maharaj met him. He was very happy to meet him. This young man was tormented by the bad, evil thoughts. How? By just looking at the form of mother and repeating her name, thinking about her, overcame all the evil thoughts and became as pure, so as to become a brahmachari of the order under Swami Brahmananda. So Holy Mother has given us a greatest teaching through this incident, that we need not be afraid of evil things. Evil things will bombard us. If you go into the street, evil thoughts are there, evil pictures are there. If you take out a newspaper, evil news is there, advertisements are there. Everything is full of evil. The more you become sensitive to good things, and you will become sensitive to evil things also. So they affect you. What is the way to get out of the evil? Think of Mother. Think of her teachings. Think of her divine form. More you think about her, you yourself will feel that all that evil has gone away. Mother has purified everything. So she has given all of us a right royal way to get out of the evil thoughts, of our evil thoughts. That is, to think about her thoughts, her words under divine form. So on this auspicious day, we have seen several facets of Mother. More we read about Mother, more we see the uniqueness with all this. When people used to meet Mother, they used to feel so simple about her. Nobody could think there was a greatness about it. There was nothing to express that she is an extraordinary person. And now and then the extraordinariness would flash. And then after she has passed away, so much about her has been written and we are all reading it. Now we realize what a great person was there. But when she was alive, very few people realized that was the glory of them. That is, Sri Ramakrishna used to describe the avatara. We will close with that one. Avatara cannot be known. That is the greatness of the avatara. If you know an avatara, then avatara is no avatara. Sri Ramakrishna used to compare. Avatara is like a king going in disguise to know about the country. Like Vikramaditya, he used to go around the whole city, dressed himself as a beggar or somebody else. People would not know. Then as soon as a few people came to know, though he is dressed as a beggar, he looked like Vikramaditya. If one or two people said, he will go back to the palace. He would never go afterwards. Because everybody will come to know. He cannot get any secret news. So Sri Ramakrishna says, avataras are those whom people cannot know. By the time people come to know, maybe he is an avatara, he leaves the world and go. Sri Ramakrishna also said, when people talk about me, that he is an avatar, then I will leave this world. He did it. Similarly, Holy Mother also, until her last day, people all thought she is an ordinary woman only. Now we know, after 150 years, or 160 years, 164 years, how great she was. And perhaps after another 1600 years, they will know much more greater than what we are thinking today. So the avataras are very difficult to know, and such was the Holy Mother's life. We are all fortunate, and it is by the blessings of Holy Mother that we could talk about her, think about her for a short while. So may we pray to her, may we pray to Sri Ramakrishna, that they shower their blessings upon us, that we always think about them, we meditate upon them and become free from all our worries and lead a peaceful and joyful life, both in a secular sense and in a spiritual sense also. May Sri Ramakrishna and Mother bless us all. Jananim Sharadam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagadgurum Padapadme Tayo Shritva Pranamami Moham.